say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, will forgive our sins, and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of Christ,
Sunday of Easter is from Numbers chapter 21. From Mount Hor they set out by the way to the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom. And the people became impatient on the way. And the people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and we loathe this worthless food. Then the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people so that many people of Israel died. And the people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord that he take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people, and the Lord said to Moses, "Make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole, and everyone who is bitten, when he sees it, shall live." So Moses made a bronze serpent and set it on a pole. And if a serpent bit anyone, he would look at the bronze serpent and live. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Speaking plainly and not using figurative speech. Now we we know that you know all things and do not need anyone to question you. This is why we believe that you came from God. Jesus answered them, "Do you now believe? Behold, the hour is coming. Indeed, it has come, when you will be scattered, each to his own home, and will leave me alone. Yet I am not alone, for the Father is with me. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
you about two things you can be sure of. And no, I'm not talking about death and taxes. I'm talking tribulation and peace. Tribulation and peace. Two things that you can be sure of. Two things that you can count on. Two things that are guaranteed to come your way if you are a Christian. I'm not talking about one of those really good Christians who knows how to live the right way. Or I'm talking about the Christians who are dealing with tribulation. So let's start with tribulation. It's just a big fancy word for trouble. This is something you can expect. This experience of tribulation. Jesus tells his disciples as much in the Holy Gospel for today, from John chapter 16. He says, in the world you will have tribulation. Notice that he doesn't say, you might have tribulation. No, you will have tribulation. It's guaranteed if you're in the world, you're gonna have trouble. And if you believe the words of Jesus, then you better believe there will be tribulation. And we know that that trouble can come in all kinds of various forms and sources. There's the trouble that comes simply from living in a fallen world. Things don't work right. Cars break down. Nature doesn't work right. Hearing in the news about all these tornadoes and hail damage and flooding. Of course, we know people don't always do the right thing. Oftentimes, they do things that hurt us, whether directly or indirectly. Of course, we can think about things like economic decisions that are way above our heads that cost us money, or more directly, the thieves that would break in and steal our stuff. And then there's emotional hurt. People we care about betray us or break our hearts. People we love, we see them suffering. And of course, we suffer too. We lose the people that we love, whether to death or to distance, and we miss them. And all of these troubles come simply from living in a fallen world. And when it comes to trouble, it doesn't matter if you're a Christian or not. You've got your troubles. I've got mine. You've got yours. But the point is, we all have them. In one form or another. And this fallen world, for all the joy that it can offer us, surely seems to bombard us with just enough trouble to never let us rest or be satisfied. Life never seems to stay right where we want it. Fortunes can come and go, friends as well. It seems that just when things are going the way that we want it, something has to come and rain on our parade. Friends, trouble is everywhere in the world. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't play identity politics. It doesn't matter if you're fat or fit, rich or poor, white or black. It doesn't matter. We are all humans living in a fallen particular endure. And that, I think, is what Jesus is especially talking about when he tells his disciples, in the world you will have tribulation. The whole context in these chapters of John is about how things are going to be different now that Jesus is going away, now that he is returning to his Father. When life is about to get a whole lot more difficult for the disciples. Remember, Jesus is saying all of this on the night in which he is about to be betrayed. When he's going to be arrested, when he's going to be put on trial. In the morning, he will be taken before the governor. He'll be scourged and mocked, unjustly sentenced. And then he will be put to death on the cross. You want to talk about trouble? That is trouble. And the world that hated Jesus is going to hate his followers too. Disciples get treated like their master. So Jesus is preparing them for what comes next. And he's preparing us as well. In the world, you will have tribulation. As one person in our Bible study put it this morning, we can look at tribulation as those things which challenge our faith. Now, whether back in the first century, or even now in the 21st century, the followers of Jesus have always been facing such tribulation in the world. For it is a hostile place for Christians. The values of the world conflict with what Christians believe and how we are to live. Think of all the evils that the world considers good in its eyes. And obviously, abortion, unnatural marriage, greed, gambling, divorce, hookup culture and pornography, and certainly sexual immorality of every kind. The world calls these evils good, and it calls the good evil. They not only do these things, but give approval to those who do them, and they curse those who would dare say otherwise. And it's no surprise, then, that the world is so hostile to Christians and to what they believe, teach, and confess. If a Christian calls a thing what it is, if we, in other words, call sin, sin, if we know and say and demonstrate by our lives that certain behaviors are right and certain behaviors are wrong, or what God himself would say about any matter, well, then guess what? We represent a threat to what the world wants and what it wants to do. We represent a threat to those things that the world finds so satisfying, at least satisfying for the moment. And what's more, trusting in God and in his goodness, believing that salvation is to be found in Jesus Christ alone and not in the false gods of man's own making, we represent a condemnation of idolatry and false belief. When we say that all men are sinners and are not righteous in themselves, and that all people need the righteousness that is found only in Christ, then guess what? This goes against the pride of the world and the pride of mankind. And you better believe that the world will hate you for this. How dare we trouble them with peace? And so we stand at the crosshairs of the world hating us because they first hated Christ. Thus we can count on the fact that in this world we will have tribulation. Just as Jesus said we would. It's guaranteed. Tribulation, trouble. I'm sure we feel this pressure. And when you're in it, when those troubles are pressing in, that really is how it feels when you're going down the pit. You feel all alone, like no one knows the troubles or the sorrow. But remember, your brothers and your sisters here in this family called the Christian Church, we also have been through the storms. We are called to care. care and to support one another when we see a brother or a sister who is hurting. As it says in 2 Corinthians, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all of our affliction, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. You might remember that old song, nobody knows the trouble I've seen, nobody knows but Jesus. That's the big thing for us, isn't it? That Jesus knows what we're going through. He is the man of sorrows. He is acquainted with grief. For we have a high priest, now ascended at the right hand of God, one who is able to sympathize with us in our weaknesses and in our troubles. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Cast your cares on him, for he cares for you. Call upon me in the day of trouble, God says, promising, I will deliver you and you shall glorify me. Ask and you will receive, that your joy may be full. So just as tribulation is guaranteed for us Christians, so also is God's peace guaranteed. Listen again to what Jesus says to his disciples. I have said these things to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. But take heart, I have overcome the world. Likewise, earlier in this same discourse, Jesus had said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Peace. The peace of God in Christ Jesus. This peace which the world cannot give, Jesus gives to you. It's a peace that the world cannot take away, even in the midst of tribulation, especially in the midst of your tribulation. You have this peace. This peace to comfort and to quiet your soul. In the world, you will have tribulation. In Christ, you will have peace. Peace guaranteed. For he has given you his name, washing you in holy baptism, regenerating you in the Holy Spirit. This means life. This means salvation. The washing of water and word. Now, this is not just happy talk. This is not a denial of reality. This is not wishful thinking or whistling past the graveyard, as some would say. This is not saying, peace, peace. There is no peace. No, there really is this peace, guaranteed, objectively so. It exists. It is objectively established. Peace is a reality. Even when we can't see it or feel it, this is the peace that Christ has established by his death on the cross and by his resurrection from the tomb. Christ Jesus making this peace in his body on the cross. Jesus making peace between heaven and earth, between God and man. Our sins had alienated us from God. We were by nature enemies of God. But Christ has now reconciled us back to God, buying us back, redeeming us, establishing peace in our hearts. He has drowned our sin. He's dragged our fallen nature to the cross and put it to death. experiencing tribulation of any sort, especially that which comes at the end of our lives, we know that we are at peace with God, and that changes everything. Whatever the worst, whatever it is that the world can do to us, whatever is the worst thing in your life that this fallen world has dished out at you, we know that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. For God is at peace with us, and we at peace with God. Nothing we could do can disturb that. But we have been baptized, and we believe the promises that he first gave to his apostles. And so this objective peace, as I like to put it, this peace that Christ establishes, it brings a subjective peace, I dare say, the feeling of peace to our hearts and minds and souls. And like we discussed in Wednesdays in the Word, when we talk about subjective justification, we're not just talking about what you think your salvation is. We're speaking about what Christ has done for you individually and together as a whole. For you as a part of the body of Christ. You being the subject. We're not talking about what we think salvation is, but what salvation is and what it has done to each one of us. We are the subject of Christ's saving work. We have been crucified with him and buried in the washing for forgiveness. His death is our death. This death in the body is life. This death is the end of tribulation and trouble. And what a great comfort and relief in the midst of our sorrows. What a relief this truly is. For we know that right now our Heavenly Father is watching over us and he cares for us. We know that right now Jesus Christ, our Savior, knows each one of us by name. That he continues interceding for us, and that he is ruling all things for the sake of his holy church. We have the Holy Spirit speaking peace to our hearts. We know that ahead of us, when this brief life of tribulation comes to an end, that there is but eternal peace and eternal joy of the life to come. We join that white-robed multitude who have come out of this great tribulation, those who have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Dear friends, you have been baptized in the name of Jesus, and you trust in him for your salvation. Your names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You have a place reserved in the holy city, the New Jerusalem. This is guaranteed. Life and light will fill that city. God, all his saints will be there. And so will you and I be there, ever rejoicing. And it is all because of the peace that is guaranteed in the crucified and risen Christ. It is because of this peace that is won and established in us by faith. For Christ has overcome the world. He forgives you your sins. The peace that he gives you is greater than any of your troubles. His peace is greater than our feelings. And this peace is yours today, and it will get you through tomorrow, guaranteed. This peace of God which surpasses all understanding, keeping your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. has overcome the world for us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear me, I pray.
Gracious Father, we thank you for raising up faithful shepherds among us to feed and serve your holy flock. Fill them with your Spirit that they would never tire of preaching Christ and him crucified for the salvation of all who hear and believe. Lord, in your mercy,
hear me our prayer.
Almighty Father, keep this nation under your care and bless the leaders of our land. Heal our divisions, that we may be a people at peace among ourselves and a blessing to the other nations of the earth. Give us grateful hearts for the freedoms we enjoy and for the men and women who have given their lives to keep us free. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful Father, extend your compassionate and caring hand toward all who suffer tribulation in this sinful world, especially to the destitute, homeless, and those impoverished. Motivate your children to be doers of the word and not hearers only, that they would be your instruments of love to help and assist those in need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving Father, look with mercy upon all those who are sick or suffering in any way, especially Pat, Bob, Jean, Malcolm, Thomas, Mary Jane, Wanda, Ron, Janine, Joanne, Becky, Janice, Josh, Ron, Betsy, Bobby, Corey, Caroline, Irvin, Beth, Teddy, Arnold, Maxine, Joe, Edith, and Lori. Comfort them in the sure and certain knowledge that their Redeemer lives and that they have the promises of life eternal through him. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, bring us to the holy altar in repentance and faith, that we might receive a foretaste of the feast to come and the eating and drinking of your Son's very body and blood. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Eternal Father, we give you thanks for receiving all those who have gone to their heavenly reward before us and now rest from their labors. Keep us with them in the same faith, that together with them we may receive the promised inheritance of your eternal kingdom, as fellow heirs with your Son when he returns in glory on the last day. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through faith in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name of the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve.
Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good to see you all here. I want to say a special welcome to our visitors that we have here. We have quite a few here today, so.